It's everyone's friend, it's Tyler. It's everyone's friend, it's Tyler.
Hey guys, Tyler here. For this video, I'll be reacting to a Wishly Feel website I found the other day, and so without hesitation, let's react to it. Dear white parents, we can raise an anti-racist generation. Talk to your children about racism early and often. How was race invented? What is racism? What is oppression? Why are people shouting Black Lives Matter, allyship, and anti-racism? Before I respond to the content of the website, I first want to state that this whole entire title, Dear White Parents, is very fishy and peculiar to me. Like, imagine it was like a website that says, like, you know, Dear Black Parents or Dear Asian Parents. One of the main things that, of course, a colorblind generation was raised upon is to not judge people based entirely off of their race. And here we have this website saying, Dear White Parents, and judging the parents based upon their race. But let's check out the content some more. We can raise an anti-racist generation. Children as young as 4 years old can show signs of racial bias, but they can also exhibit an understanding of fairness and equity. White parents have a unique opportunity to contribute to a more inclusive, just, and equitable society by talking to their children about racism early and often. Research suggests that adults whose parents spoke to them about racism when they were children are more likely to speak about their own children about racism, resulting in intergenerational impact. Together, we can raise an anti-racist generation and blend the 400-year-old trajectory of racism, creating a new reality around race for future generations. First and foremost, I first want to state that I'm not against the idea of teaching racism towards little kids, mostly because parents have an opportunity to tell their kids that it's not okay to judge people based upon their race. And so I'm not against the very idea itself. However, in this whole entire section right there, there seems to be a manipulation of language that is being used by this website. Because when they say equity, when they say anti-racism, those terms seem very nice and very fruitful and, you know, all that kind of jazz, right? But to them, anti-racism is not, you know, being against racism. To be anti-racist, according to various books like How to Be Anti-Racist, you have to be against the very idea of colorblindness, that you want equality of outcomes rather than, of course, equality of opportunity. And to be against, you know, like racism, you have to be like anti-capitalist. That's what was in the book for How to Be Anti-Racist. And so anti-racism may sound like a really nice word, but at the same time, it's not necessarily, you know, what it seems to be. It's just a cover-up for their own personal political ideology. Not to mention, according to the book, it says that there's only racists and anti-racists, and that the people who do not call themselves the anti-racists, the neutrals, more or less they're being racist for rejecting their ideas. And so, this is the type of ideology that the website's referring to. It's not referring to, you know, being against racism. There's a whole entire ideology behind it. Definitions you might need. Equity. Everyone is getting what they need in order to have access, opportunity, and a fair chance to succeed. And recognize the same for everyone equally doesn't address needs and therefore specific solutions and remedies, which may be different or necessary. Implicit bias. The unconscious attitudes and stereotypes and institutional actions, positive or negative, towards members of a group merely because of their membership in that group. Ally. Someone who speaks out on the behalf or takes actions that are supportive of someone who is targeted by bias or bullying, either themselves or someone else. A bias is an indication or preference either for or against an individual or group, interfere with an impartial judgment. Microaggression, the everyday sights, indignities, put downs, and insults that people of color, women, LGBTQ populations and other marginalized people experience in their day-to-day interactions. Microaggressions can appear to be compliments, but often contain a meta-communication or hidden assault to the target group. Microaggressions are often seen outside the level of conscious awareness of the people who say them, which means that they might be unintentional. Microaggressions may be communicated verbally or non-verbally. Privilege, the unearned and often unrecognized advantages, benefits, and rights upon people based upon their membership to a predominant group, i.e. white people, heterosexual people, men, people without disabilities, beyond what is commonly experienced by members of the marginalized group. Racism, the marginalization or oppression of people of color based on a society-constructed racial hierarchy that privileges white people. Systemic racism, a combination of systems, institutions, and factors that advantage white people for people of color cause widespread harm and disadvantages in address and opportunity. One person or even one group of people did not create systemic racism. Rather, it was grounded in the history of our laws and institutions, which were created on the foundation of white supremacy, exists in the institutions and policy that advantage white people and disadvantage people of color, and takes on places and interpersonal communication and behavior, slurs, bullying, offensive language that maintains and support systemic inequities and systemic racism. I'm not necessarily against most of the definitions as defined by the website. However, the main problems that I have are the definitions of systemic racism as well as racism. I am not going to deny in the past that the United States had the textbook definition of systemic racism, mostly because the very foundation of the country was based upon the slave labor and, of course, the mistreatment of the native people, and also what happened with Jim Crow before the Civil Rights Movement. And so there is like no denying that in the past that the United States had a history of systemic racism. But after that, however, it seemed as though that after the Civil Rights laws, more and more people started to get equal opportunity as white people in this country. And in 2022, as I record this video right now, you can do whatever you want to if you put your mind and effort behind it. There's literally nothing in the system that prevents you from doing whatever kind of career path that you want. Even if you were poor and you have like a lot of struggles, you can still make in this country through hard work and effort and determination. Now, as far as the racial disparities is concerned, just because a company don't have a lot of minorities depends largely on the various factors. Like, there are some states that might have like a small percentage of minorities versus the majority population, and so that's why it seems as though that white people are more overrepresented in some parts of the countries. However, in states where it's like a minority only, you know, states, like, you know, places like, you know, I guess Miami or whatever, of course, more minorities are going to be represented. And so I think just because there is like a low racial representation of somebody does not mean that the whole entire country is still systemically racist. Now, as far as this whole entire definition of racism, to me, racism is literally just prejudice against somebody because of their skin color. There are some people that argue that they cannot be racist solely because of their race. That's like a stupid definition. At the same time, I don't necessarily, you know, agree with that definition of racism either. What is race and racism? What is race? There are probably as many definitions of race as there are scholarly fields that explore the human condition. Pulling from the field of anthropology can help in taking a somewhat objective view on the topic. According to the American Anthropology Association, race is a recent human invention is only a few hundred years old in comparison to the lengthy span of human history. Though not scientific, the idea of race proposed that there were significant differences among people that allowed them to be grouped into a number of categories of races. What is racism? I would be remiss if I didn't talk at least briefly about racism and the ongoing efforts throughout history to dismantle it. My standard definition of racism is racial prejudice combined with power, and in a country founded on the idea that white is better, that power is typically not wielded by people of color. It was white elite power that enabled and prevented legal segregation, the enforced separation of different racial groups for nearly 90 years, a power that is also wielded by non-elite whites. But it was grassroots people power that also included many white people that dismantled it and led to desegregation, the ending of the policy of racial segregation. Of course, the struggle to end segregation would not have been possible without the work of advocates, people speaking out in support or in advance of a cause. There were days we sometimes refer to them as stand-uppers. We've seen thousands of them in the recent public protests and demonstrations in support of Black Lives Matter, a movement that advocates for nonviolent civil disobedience to protest police brutality and other racial motivated violence against Black people. I can imagine that Black Lives Matter started with a conversation about race. Oh yes, Black Lives Matter is like totally nonviolent. It's not as if, of course, what happened in 2020 with the riots going on in the various states didn't happen. It's not as if, of course, that Black Lives Matter try to say that they cannot be racist against white people because of their own personal skin color. It's not as if Black Lives Matter also said to destroy the nuclear family, or that Black Lives Matter just openly admitted to being highly trained Marxists. And it's not as if, of course, Black Lives Matter tried to, of course, support the Cuban government. You see, Black Lives Matter is very innocent, and so we just support the movement no matter how bad their ideas really are. So what can I conclude from all of this? More or less, this campaign seems to be designed with the intent of making parents into, like, you know, whole entire, oh my god, I need to talk again. More or less, is using parents as a spawn to indoctrinate their personal children into far left ideologies and to make sure that racial tensions continue to be high in this country. And to, you know, shame them and, of course, use like a lot of buzzwords and to support far left movements. And so, I don't necessarily think that this campaign is gonna help out my country. But what do you guys think? Tell me in the comment section down below. And as always, I'll see you guys in the next video.
It's everyone's friend, it's Tyler.
He's your only black friend, so he's your best black friend. I wouldn't trade him for another black friend. Because black friends are rare, as you should be aware. He smiles like Richard Pryor, so just sit and stare.
It's everyone's friend, it's Tyler. It's everyone's friend, it's Tyler. It's everyone's friend, it's Tyler.